English, and it will be led by respected P.P. Mathew sir, a senior journalist and someone with vast experience in the field. But before getting into the session, let me welcome all of you present here. First of all, I would like to welcome our respected manager, George Kuriakose sir, the backbone of Nirmal Arts and Science College. It is his vision and planning that has transformed our college into newer heights every academic year. Dr. Geeta C.A., the principal of the college, and her experience in academics, experience as a HOD of the Cochin College, that's what drives us, that's what inspires us teachers to go the extra mile every day. Welcome, ma'am. And our respected Dean of the College, D.C. N.O., who is the head of all the programs being conducted in the college. She inspires not only us teachers, but also the students to take up many challenges and be a better version of ourselves every day. Thank you, ma'am, for being part of our life. We welcome you with utmost respect. And now I would like to welcome the chief guest of the day, P.P. Mathew sir. He is the most important person for the day and the most apt person. I said most apt because he's a postgraduate in English from Maharaja's College and also a journalist with amazing career. And when I say amazing career, I'm not exaggerating at all. I have gone through his profile and it's amazing. We are honored to have you.
I'm profusely elated to take an opportunity to introduce our resource person today, P.P. Mathew sir. I have pointed out a list of things out of which I would like to mention some of them. First of all, P.P. Mathew sir joined Manorama in 1978 when the Cochin unit was launched and worked till 1997 and resigned as the senior editor. And he left for Bahrain to join the launching team of Bahrain Tribune. And 1.5 years later, he moved to Sharjah as world news editor at the Gulf Today and worked there till 2017. He still works for them online. At Manorama, he specialized in foreign affairs and cinema, which was a passion. And he covered 11 international film festivals in India and edited Manorama's cinema page for almost 16 years. And I would like to mention some of his major reporting assignments abroad, out of which the first one is he's traveled with Rajiv Gandhi to the US, Germany, Hungary, and Syria. And he reported 1992 election of Bill Clinton. And he covered Kuwait rebuilding after the Iraq invasion. And Mathew sir visited China post Tiananmen Square massacre for a study of the related issues. Now I would like to mention some other assignments which he did successfully completed in India, which are 1918 Lok Sabha election and Bhopal gas tragedy. And he launched Vijay Vidhi and Toril Vidhi before resigning from Manorama. So it's our pleasure to have you here, sir.
I would now prefer to go into a question answer session. If anybody has any doubts to ask or anything they would like to hear from me, please.
Okay. I ask a question about the films you said. Each film from different countries should be seen within their culture and their different perspective, isn't it? Say, how appealing will be a film like, say, Chemin to, say, a European viewer? So, will they be able to appreciate the film as we appreciate the film? So, there must be some constraints in reporting as well as appreciating a film which is made in a foreign country or in a foreign background with a foreign in their foreign culture, isn't it? Or so, how will you?
Good question, sir. About Chemin, I would say, as you know, it was translated into more than 100 languages, so it was very widely read work. That's one thing. We watching foreign films like Eastern European or African, there we need to have a primary knowledge of certain cultural things
like it have that is relevant of even American films. If you watch American films, you will find that. Now we learn British English basically here. The American colloquialism in many of the films are a bit difficult to grasp. There are people who don't understand what it is. Now here, the reporter needs to have fairly good information before venturing out to watch these films. Like if you are talking of a problem in Tanzania, the film, you get a brochure before you go into the theater. You get a brochure about all the details of the film and what this is, what the cultural background is, why this was made and why this was an issue. So you have all that information available. With that information, when you watch, you won't have much difficulty. I have never found any difficulty. I have watched a film on Bosnia, which was not at all difficult for me because Bosnia was news all over the world and it was continuously. And since I specialize in foreign affairs also, I was very thorough on those things. But again on Sri Lanka, the LTT problem was going on. That one film I watched, it was very easy to grasp. But there are areas in Africa, like remote areas, where certain films are of high quality, but as you said, the cultural background, the political background, these things, we have to have a brief before we go inside. They provide you the brochure. Indian Film Festival, those who conduct the festival authority, they provide you detailed brochure on every film. So it's not at all that difficult. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Sir, can we move on to the next question by Selvi?
Sure.
Media credibility is degrading day by day. As a citizen, what can we do for its betterment?
Well, I don't know. That's a hard question. Media credibility is definitely going down. I do agree with that. That's because of this sensationalism. But I would, rather than credibility, I'm worried of the quality of reporting, writing, everything, even headings. If you go to print media, the fact is that they are suffering terribly. After the eruption of this pandemic, they don't even have ads. The pages are very little. So you open a page, they have reduced pages. Manorama, for example, they have reduced their pages. The metro section is gone. And you pass through the pages, you find ads are very limited. They have problem of survival. Now, every television channel has the same problem. They software is expensive. Now, they have to make software. They find it a problem. But I think serials, maybe because so many families are obsessed with serials. Serials are bringing them money. Surya channel has discarded their news section and they have got only serials and they are getting money. About credibility. You know, credibility, coming back to credibility, I don't remember an example from the recent past to cite about credibility. That's credibility comes up. The question of credibility comes up when a news story is proven as false. Somebody reports something and next day the newspaper has to make a correction. This was wrong. You made a wrong reporting. These things happen, but I don't know. I haven't noticed many examples in the recent past, of course. Especially now, the hot news is COVID, number one. And then, of course, the gold smuggling and the political stories and all that. These are running, and of course, those who are attacked or those on whom allegations are raised, they will deny it and they will say this is a false story, and that is there. But we have our own ways of judging credibility. When we find that somebody, the channel and he denies it. And in the evening, the ED, the enforcement department, comes out with a statement saying that he was questioned. Then the credibility is proven. The credibility is lost when a news story is denied. If you can cite an example, I can specifically answer about that. Thank you.